To be here with you this evening to bring the Word of God. You know, we're beginning a truly magnificent letter in the New Testament. Ephesians tells the believer of their great riches, their inheritance and fullness in Yeshua. It tells us how rich we are and how we can claim and enjoy our possessions right now, right here on earth. So let's look at the outline. Everybody has an outline. The outline of the letter of Ephesians, the first page of your handout. We can divide this book into five different sections. The first two verses from the first section, which is the salutations. The second section from chapter 1, verse 3 to chapter 2, 22, is part of the doctrinal section. It presents the Messiah as the head and owner of the church that he purchased with his blood and that he enlightens with his grace. The members of the church are seen here as sealed and indwelled by the Spirit of God. It is in this section that Israel is spoken of. How can one deal with the doctrine of the church without speaking of Israel? Here they are shown to be strongly associated with the body of the Messiah. This portion of the Bible is crucial in that it brings us to make sense of the position of Israel and that of the church in the Bible. Israel permeates the scriptures from Genesis to Revelation, and a good grasp of the message of the Bible would depend very much of our understanding of Israel past, present, and future. Otherwise, one may find himself either idolizing the Jews, or having an indifferent attitude towards them, or even developing feelings of resentment toward the nation of God. Ephesians will help us to get a proper view of the nation in relation to the church. The third section deals with a very special position of the church as a revealed mystery. What the Hebrew Scriptures did not reveal is that Jews and Gentiles would be fellow heirs of the same body and partakers of God's promises in the Messiah through the Scriptures. Here we see them both as one, belonging to one family. The fourth section is the practical aspect of all those wonderful truths. It is here where Paul asks us, what are you going to do with all these blessings and all these great truths that we've just seen? It is here where the believer is asked to walk in unity, in holiness, in purity, and in love. This section really brings out this aspect of the law of Christ that penetrates deep into our souls, and where the words of Romans 12:1, where the law of Christ, by the way, really begins, which says that we ought to give ourselves as a living sacrifice, is here expounded for us. It is in this section of Ephesians where marriage is brought to a new level. Here the Spirit of God asks the husband to love their wives, just as Yeshua loves the church and gave his life for her. The bar is high. Other relationships are dealt with as well, the relationship between parents and children, between masters and servants, all of this in order to have a healthy and well-functioning new body of the Messiah. The fifth section, which is found in chapter 6, ends with the armor of God, an invaluable teaching of the Bible that bids us to realize that we are in a battleground, and that we really need to walk very closely with the Spirit of God, putting on the armor, his armor, and by going by his might. And the stress is put on his, here, his might and his armor, not our might or power. And notice two things in this outline. There are two of Paul's prayers that really interrupts the flow of the message, section 2b and 3b. What are the prayers doing in the middle of the letter? I believe that Paul was so overwhelmed by the depth of the things he was inspired to write that the Spirit of God allows him to pause and to praise. These are truly of the most beautiful prayers found in the Scriptures. And the truth found in this letter cannot be confined to any geographical or historical situation. While this was written to the Ephesians, we find that the words in Ephesus in chapter 1, verse 1, is missing in two of the oldest manuscripts, which suggests that it was intended as a circular letter to neighboring churches and was intended for all the congregation throughout Christian history as well. The truth in there are too large, too important to be restricted to only one place. So in this letter, Paul gives us a complete tour of our surroundings. He first carries us to the heavenlies to see those great blessings that await us and whose benefits we can enjoy now. Then he brings us back to earth and reminds us how we should now walk as believers, considering all that power and blessings that were given to us. And then he brings us down below and lists for us a series of sins that characterizes this world. This is throughout the epistles. And there reminds us, again, that we are no more to walk according to the values of this world. And finally, he lays down for us the armor we need to go through this journey and properly live by God's standard. So this letter could also be considered as a manual of survival for the believer while he or she is journeying through this earth. One key phrase that we often encounter in Ephesians are the words, in Christ, which are repeated 15 times. The words in him or in himself are also found repeated 8 times. The words in the Lord are repeated 7 times. You know, that's a total of 30 times. Yeshua really wants us to know that he is with us at all times. This book is about our relationship with him and portrays our Lord as a loving provider of eternal blessing, as a source, the guarantee of every spiritual blessing. One other important word also found repeated in here is the word grace, the means through which all of these blessings are bestowed on us. This word is repeated 12 times, more than in Philippians and Colossians together. Ephesians is really an exposition of the gospel of God's grace. You know, commentators call Ephesians the believer's bank, the Christian's checkbook, and the treasure house of the Bible. So I'm very excited, and it's my prayer today that you will be very blessed to see all these things that we have in this letter. Now let's go in history and see under which condition Paul was under when he wrote this letter. This is not in your handout, this is an extra. We may have thought that Paul was on a beautiful island under a palm tree, free of all worries, to allow these words to come to him, but far from that, this letter was actually written when Paul was a prisoner. It was written when Paul was waiting to be judged by the Romans. On him was luring the possibility of a harsh sentence. For many, it may not have been the ideal condition to write a book, but these were the ideal conditions for the Spirit of God to inspire men. John the Apostle, we remember, wrote Revelation in exile and under very harsh condition as well in the island of Patmos. David also wrote his great messianic psalms when he was constantly pursued by Saul, who wanted to kill him. It is under this condition where we are more receptive to the Spirit of God. As Paul said in 2 Corinthians 12, "For when I am weak, then I am strong." Let us look at the historical background of this letter. You can see the chart on the screen as to when this letter was written in relation to the other letters of the New Testament. I'll be using the PowerPoint mainly to show maps and graphs and also to list most verses that are outside of the book of Ephesians so that you do not have to flip through your Bible. Like this, we can go faster. Ephesians was written from Rome at about 64 AD. It was a so-called prison epistle, along with Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon. These were all written when Paul was a prisoner in Rome. Before this time, 10 years earlier, at about the year 54 AD, during his first missionary journey, Paul ministered in Ephesus, but did not remain there for long. This account is found in Acts chapter 18, verses 19 to 21. The reason why Paul did not stay a long time there is because he had to go to Jerusalem for the coming feast, it says, probably the feast of Passover. We understand that Paul had kept much of his Jewish customs. It was decreed in the Mosaic law that every Jew should be in Jerusalem at the temple 3 times a year during the feast of Passover, Pentecost, and Tabernacles. Paul was no more under the law, but he kept many Jewish customs so long as they did not interfere with the word of God. 2 years later, while on his third missionary journey, Paul stayed in Ephesus, but this time for 3 years. And it is then that he founded the church of Ephesus, and from there a great work of evangelization began. The account of this ministry is found in Acts chapter 19 and Acts chapter 20. During his 3 years stay in Ephesus, several truly remarkable things happened in through this city. God worked some unusual miracles through Paul. For instance, one exceptional miracle is related to us in Acts 19, verses 11 to 12, where we read, "Now God worked unusual miracles by the hands of Paul, so that even handkerchiefs or aprons were brought from his body to the sick, and the diseases left them, and the evil spirits went out from them." Now imagine, just his handkerchief was healing people. Why these miracles here, and why that is here in Ephesus? While the church was still in its infancy, and while the word of God was not yet complete, its writers needed to be recognized as those that were chosen by the Lord. I also believe that the strength of Paul's miracles at Ephesus is proportionate to the importance of the message that we find in this letter. New truths are given and new mysteries are revealed to us. We also understand that it is through Ephesus that much of the word spread to the outer parts of Asia Minor. We know that Timothy was a pastor in this church, and the letter of 1 and 2 Timothy were written while he was at Ephesus. According to an old tradition, Timothy continues to act as pastor of Ephesus and suffered martyrdom under Domitian. And from Ephesus, this letter found their way to the other churches. Also, according to Eusebius, John the Apostle spent his last years in Ephesus. It was this city that is believed to have been John the Apostle's home congregation after Jerusalem. And it's from there that he went and taught in the six other churches of Revelation. This city then played an important role in the spreading of the scriptures in the Roman world. And if the miracles were so powerful in Ephesus, this was probably also proportionate to the level of superstition that the Ephesians were under. You know, where sin abounds, grace much more abounds. It was there that we find the Asiatic goddess Artemis, or Diana, whose temple, one of the seven wonders of the world, stood there. This temple made the city famous and a major center of religion at that time. A historian of that time, Pliny, described this temple as magnificent, with a length of 425 feet and a width of 225 feet. It had 127 columns, 60 feet in height, that supported the roof. But the reproduction of the statue of Diana as it came to us today is so unpleasant that I did not think it fit to be shown in this place. It was in this city that the courageous Paul performed exorcism, and many sorcerers and priests, we are told, came to believe in Yeshua. So much so that the scriptures report that many people converted and brought out all their books about witchcraft and all other things that they were teaching there and burned them. This we read in Acts 19:19. There it says, "Also many of those who had practiced magic brought their books together and burned them in the sight of all, and they counted up the value of them, and it totaled 50,000 pieces of silver." According to one estimate, to the value of money at that time would be equivalent to approximately $350,000. That's a lot of books. So his ministry in this city was so successful that the many merchants of this city, those who were selling the statues of Diana, they rioted over the loss of business because people were not buying the statues anymore. And Ephesus was also a major economical center in the area. Some estimated a population of 225,000 people with a considerable Jewish population. Josephus, in his book Antiquities, infers that they were in great number in this city. There were a number of synagogues also in this city, and this is where Paul began his ministry. Both times when he came in Ephesus, as he always did, when he entered a new territory, he went to the Jews first. And it was those first Jews and proselytes who followed him and laid the foundation of the Church of Ephesus. Many people tell us today, how can we go to the Jew first? In our congregation at Montreal, at Betariel, we do go to the Jew first. But you know that we get more Gentiles who come to believe than Jews themselves. When you go to the Jew first, you get the Jews and the Gentiles. If you leave the Jews, you'll never get to the Jews themselves. And there's some blessings attached to it. So at the time, synagogues were not only places of worship, they were community centers where they will often invite different speakers to hear the news concerning especially the land of Israel. And it is in this second visit in Ephesus, we learned that Paul preached for quite a long time in the synagogue. He stayed 3 months until some of them realized that his teaching did not go at all with what rabbinical Judaism teaches. It took them quite a long time to realize all of that. It is then that he departed and took with him the new believers in Yeshua, Jews and Gentiles. Again, those Gentiles were either some proselytes or God-fearers. The proselytes were those who converted to Judaism. And the God-fearers were Gentiles who believed in the God of Israel but did not become full proselytes. An example of this is Cornelius, as we have it in Acts chapter 10. From there, Paul and his converts formed what became the Church of Ephesus. You can find again the account of his stay in Acts chapter 19. Among the people at Ephesus were Aquila and Priscilla. These were among the Jews that were expelled from Rome. After living in Corinth, where they met Paul, they followed him in Ephesus. They shared the same trade of tent making with Paul. Another prominent Jew found there was Apollos, most likely an Egyptian Jew. He was from Alexandria, a disciple of John the Baptist who came to Ephesus and was taught by Priscilla and Aquila, who explained to him the way of God more accurately. This you find it in Acts 18:26. After that, he went to many other cities and preached the word of God with very much success. There is one great truth we should not miss in all that. The difference between this world and the kingdom of God in this world. The fact that Paul was not welcome in Ephesus and in many other cities of the world right at the birth of the church, and the fact that believers throughout history up to today are also not very welcomed in this world, stresses the fact that the church does not belong to this world and would certainly not change this world. As prophecies indicate, the world will go from bad to worse until Jesus comes back. But the believers, as Paul in Ephesus, can be the medium through which the lives of many people from this world can be changed and saved. If the believer thinks he can change the world, as it is in, we find this in increasing number today, then he is heading for a great disappointment. The truth is imperative to grasp. It is imperative to rest our position here on earth in order to bear much fruits. What happened to the Ephesians later on? On the return from his third missionary journey, Paul met with the Ephesians elders at Miletus and warned them to beware of evil teachers from without and of professing believers from within who would teach perverse things. This you find in Acts 20. Verses 17 to 31. There we read, from Miletus he sent to Ephesus and called for the elders of the church, and he says to them, "For I know this, that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. Also from among yourself, men will rise up, speaking perverse things, to draw away the disciples after themselves. Therefore watch and remember that for 3 years I did not cease to warn everybody night and day with tears." 10 years later, these savage wolves were faithful to their appointment. They had begun to invade Ephesus and the neighboring congregations. At the time of John the Apostle, many of these wolves were causing much damage. The first, second, and third letter of John deals with these things. From Yeshua's address to this congregation in Revelation 2, we understand that Ephesus did suffer the attack from some false apostles, those who say that they were apostles but were not. And also a group named Nicolaitans, probably a religious group, who had tried to usurp the authority of the leaders and of the scriptures. Neighboring churches were also under the influence of these same wolves. Some, as Revelation points out, were holding the doctrines of Balaam. Others were tolerating the presence of Jezebel. All these are false doctrines. While others disturbed the whole decree of God in the scriptures in pretending to be Jews, but were not, in Yeshua's words, these were a synagogue of Satan. All of these things were put in place to disturb the growth of the body of the Messiah. Some 300 years later, the church of Ephesus, as the other churches, became state property with the conversion of Constantine, and the tares became the majority in the visible church of God, while the wheat became the minority, as Yeshua prophesied in the parable of the kingdom in Matthew 13. These Nicolaitans did succeed. Let's now go to the text. If you have your Bible, you can open up to Ephesians chapter 1. Let's look at this first chapter. So the message, the words found in this chapter to the Ephesians, this first chapter to the Ephesians, are so, I want to tell you, beautiful. They are so encouraging. We are told that the believer is blessed according to the riches of his grace. That is, he is blessed without measure. And that he is so dear to God that he was known to him and was redeemed even before the foundation of this world. When God created the heaven and the earth, he had the believer, he had us in his mind. And he predestined us to a wonderful life in heaven and to a blessed life here on earth. And furthermore, he adopted us as son or daughter for the whole of eternity. What a great gift it is. And he values us so much that here it is also written that he reveals to us his will. He reveals, it's written, the mystery of his will, as it is written. Something no one could ever know if it is not revealed by the Spirit of God. And as an assurance of his commitment to us, we are further told in this first chapter that he has now given us the Spirit for guidance and blessing, something that he calls a pledge, like a guarantee, that assures us of these future blessings he has reserved for us in the heavenly places, when we will be with him forever. And it seems that he's so eager to experience this time for us. There exists, I want to tell you, no greater love, no greater care and concern, but the one that God, the God of the Bible, has for those who know him. Nowhere would you find such grace and mercy and willingness to give and to provide and to love. I remember reading what the Lord will tell the Israelites when they will finally come to take hold of their blessings during the Messianic times. He says to them in Obadiah chapter 1:17, "The house of Jacob shall possess their possession. They shall possess their possessions. Why did they not possess them before? They were their possessions. They missed out on it." But we need not to miss out any of these blessings that are given to us by our Lord. This epistle was written so that we may know that now we can possess all these possessions. Someone compared this letter to the Ephesians to a rose in the desert. In reality, a rose cannot survive in the desert. In another reality, that of the invisible kingdom of God, that rose may survive, as it symbolizes the one that believes in Yeshua, who redeemed him and goes through this life being fed from above by the Spirit, through the Word, and also through the Church. This is one thing that comes out strong out of this letter, as it tells us that we are rich. It also tells us that our riches are not dependent on this world where we live in, because they are all from above. Verse 1 constitutes the introduction of the book. It identifies the writer and the addressees. There we read, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and faithful in Christ Jesus. Paul was an apostle. An apostle means one who is sent. It is a messenger. In ancient Greek, this term is used to denote a fleet or naval armament. More is spoken of this function of apostle later in the epistle, but Paul was different from most other apostles in that he was not taught by any man, nor did he, at the beginning, have much communication with the members of the church. He received himself direct revelation from God. This we see it in Galatians chapter 1, verses 11 to 12. He says, "But I make known to you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached by me is not according to man, for neither received it from man, nor was I taught it, but it came through the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though he heard Stephen preach and had personal contact with Ananias and Barnabas, he was not indebted to them for his knowledge of spiritual truth. Furthermore, Paul affirmed here in Galatians that he did not receive the gospel he preached by means of some course or classes or instructions. This did cause some problem at the beginning, as many in the church could not figure out from where this man came. Besides the truth he brought, truth that fully agreed with the Hebrew scriptures, furthermore, the great power of his miracles may have played a major role in his acceptance in the church. And so Paul stands unique in the New Testament. Most of this, as we go further into, more of this as we go further, that is, into the letter. And we see another word for believers in this verse, the word saint. To the saints who are in Ephesus. This is a significant title considering the context of the scriptures. The term saint is a translation of either the Hebrew kadosh or the Greek hagios. Both the Hebrew and the Greek terms are frequently translated holy, saint or holy one, depending on the translation. While some have argued that this word may have been applied to some of the Jewish remnant once or twice in the Hebrew scriptures, the Old Testament writers characteristically apply this title to celestial beings rather than to men. These holy ones or angels were the ones who were so close to God and through whom he will often work. And here in the New Testament, this word is applied to all believers in Yeshua. This term, this new title of saint, then illuminates the believer's extraordinary sense of their nearness to God. And we need to say that the New Testament refutes the idea of a special class of elite believers called saints. Even though some believers in experience are more holy than others, yet in our position before God, we are all sanctified. We are all saints by virtue of what we are in God. We read in the following verse, verse 2. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. This is an interesting phrase. In all these phrases repeated 12 times in the New Testament. And grace always precedes peace. How can one attain peace from God if he did not first have his grace on him? What is grace? It is unmerited favor. It is something we do not deserve, but out of love, he gives it to us. Grace is a short but a very powerful word. And it is here in this chapter that we are told something more about grace. We read in verse 7 about the riches of his grace which are now available for us. And notice what it says, according to the riches of his grace. It did not say out of his riches, which would be like a millionaire giving a dollar in the offering plate, as it would be out of his riches. It according to means in proportion to. And God's proportionate provision come without measure. It is all of it that he wants to give us. That is as much as we can take. Out of this grace, of course, will give us peace. And it is from verse 3 where we are given so much information that covers so many doctrines. And until the end of the chapter, this is done in a very fast pace. It is as if Paul rushes through a series of consecutive thoughts. We understand that the letters of Paul were mostly dictated to a stenographer. It seems that in this case, it is not only Paul that was inspired, but this stenographer must have been given some kind of special blessing in order to be able to follow Paul's train of thoughts that were very, very fast until the end of this chapter. But this is an indication, by the way, of how Paul is so passionate in here. And this section, is truly beautiful. It is here that are contained a whole array of doctrines describing our blessed position with God. Let's read verses 3 to 5. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. Before anything was created, at the time when the Word was with God, we were already declared saved in Yeshua in view of the crucifixion, which we were then fully saved. Our history as believer began in eternity past, and our future as a believer will continue in eternity future. What more really can we ask? And it is here where we have this much feared word, predestined, from where we have predestination and election. So much was done with this concept of predestination, it even broke many relationships and split many churches. But we are to remember that this concept comes from above, and it is holy from above. And here in Ephesians, God allows us to peek through this wonderful truth that is touching his very nature, especially his attributes of omnipresence and omniscience. So it is no wonder that we have so much difficulties with this concept. The word predestination simply means to ordain beforehand, to predetermine. The Greek word rendered predestinate is found only 6 times in Acts 4:28, Romans 8:29 and 30, and 1 Corinthians 2:7 with Ephesians 1:5 and 11. And in all of them, it has the same meaning. They teach that the eternal, sovereign, immutable, and conditional decree are determinate purpose of God governs all events. Predestination has both a wider and a narrower aspect. In its wider aspect, it emphasizes that God has foreordained whatever comes to pass, based on Ephesians 1:11. From eternity past, God has determined all the events in history. Prophecies, in fact, testify of this, and it is, again, a very comforting truth. The narrower aspect of predestination is personal. It means from eternity past, God has elected or chosen some to salvation while allowing remaining members of humanity to go their own way. Here we should add that the Bible does not speak of unbelievers being elected. Election is confined to believers only. And the problem lies in the fact that we have difficulties reconciling the apparent contradiction between God's sovereignty and man's free will, if any, and when it comes to man's salvation. How much of man's choice can we attribute to man when it comes to salvation? Some say that there was no choice at all, that all was predestined from the beginning, while others say that there is a clear choice. But the problem is, where does one begin and the others start? How can we reconcile this dichotomy? While it is not in the scope of this study to treat this deep subject, there are two things the complexity of this concept should not deprive us of. First, we should not be deprived of the great blessing of knowing that our God knew us and has chosen us before anything was created. This is Paul's point here. We ought to realize our God loves us so much that he chose us from eternity past. It is a great comfort to know that. God, who knew us before the creation of the world, will look after us and bring us to be with him in eternity. This is what it says. Second, the depth of the difficulty of the subject should not deprive us of this great privilege and command to share our faith with others. In this case, it matters not that God knows all the people. It matters not that God knows who's going to come to believe or not. We are commanded to bring the word to the unsaved, as Paul says in Romans 10:14, and ask the question, how then shall they call upon him who they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him on whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? If one's love for the unsaved and desire to bring the word to them is disturbed because of the complexity of this doctrine, then he has definitely gone way over his head. When it comes to such a wonderful doctrine, let us limit ourselves to what is written. Actually, I have a verse for you that would link the two views. One that tremendously helped me. This verse is Deuteronomy 29:29. The secret things belong to the Lord, our God, but the things which are revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law. Moses was a unique man in the Hebrew scriptures in that, and as opposed to all others, he was the only one who spoke to God face to face, yet after his encounter with God, he realized that his understanding could go so far. The secret things belong to the Lord, he said. It is already a great grace that our minds could go as far as this point. It is like picking through another dimension. And there is another man, very powerful as well, Paul himself, who was actually given a glimpse of heaven, if you remember, in 2 Corinthians 12:2. Speaking of himself, he said, whether in the body I do not know, whether out of the body I do not know, God knows such a one was caught up in the third heaven. He was brought to heaven to see something. Furthermore, as opposed to the others of his time, as we have seen, he was the only taught directly, the only one who was taught directly by Jesus and given to unlock many mysteries. This man also understood the limits of his understanding even after seeing heaven. And he said in 1 Corinthians 4:6, do not think beyond what is written, that none of you may be puffed up on behalf of one against the other. You know, the story is told of a group of theologians who were discussing the tensions between predestination and free will. Things became so heated that the group broke up into two opposite factions. But one man, not knowing which to join, stood for a moment trying to decide. At last, he joined the predestination group. In his assessment, it seems to be the right one. Once there, they asked him, "Who sent you here?" So he replied, "No one sent me. I came from my own free will." "Free will?" they exclaim, "You go to the other group. You don't belong to us." So he followed their order and went to the other clique. There someone asked, "When did you decide to join us?" The young man replied, "Well, I didn't really decide. I was sent here." "Sent?" they said. They shouted, "You go back to the other one." You know, there's much truth in this illustration, as there are many truth in both camps. Nevertheless, I believe that this truth has been abused and dragged beyond the limit of our understanding. And back to the text, there's another beautiful truth we find in verse 5. See what it says. "Having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. He adopted us as his sons and daughters." This, by the way, is a wonderful truth here. You are not only made a saint, now you are a son of God by adoption. See how close God wants to be with each one of us. This means that once you have accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you become his child, and you enter into the family of God. That makes us true brothers and sisters in the Lord. We all belong to one family. A family will be together, as we'll be together for all eternity. And adoption guarantees your future, your eternal future, and makes you an heir, a co-heir with the only begotten Son of God, Yeshua. I do not think we can ever comprehend this blessing. I believe that even in heaven, we will always be in awe, as the angels always repeat, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty." And when it comes to our family ties, modern psychology tells us that first, it is bad to be an orphan. Second, it is terrible to be an only child. Third, damaging to be the youngest. Fourth, crushing to be in the middle. And fifth, taxing to be the oldest. There seems no way out except to be born an adult. And Christianity is here the best answer for all these things. In a way, adoption from God bypasses all these problems and takes you as you are and brings you into the family of God in there. Of course, you do not have to be an adult, but you have to understand that what Jesus did for you on the cross. And in the following verse, verse 6, we read other great words. You know, reading Ephesians is to go from one blessing to another, from grace to grace. See what it says. "To the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he has made us accepted in the beloved." We first read that he has accepted us because we cannot make ourselves acceptable to God. Salvation is purely by grace, and there's nothing we can do to attain it. This is something that Paul will elaborate later in this epistle. And he has made us accepted in whom? It says in the Beloved. This is such a nice and personal touch from Paul. He calls his Lord the Beloved. That is reminiscent of the baptism of Yeshua in Matthew 3:17, where God the Father says about his Son, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." The following verse in Ephesians 1:7 speaks of another important doctrine, that of redemption. See what it says. "In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace." To redeem someone is to set him from paying a price. This word comes from a Greek word meaning to purchase in the marketplace. And it had to do with the selling and buying of slaves. You know, today, this might not mean much to us, but consider what it meant to the people of the time. Someone said that there were 60 million slaves in the Roman Empire, and they were often bought and sold like pieces of furniture. Slavery was rampant, and redemption was one of the only way for a slave to be freed. And there is yet another word that is linked with redemption. It is forgiveness. One comes as a consequence of the other. Verse 7 again reads, "In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. As the result of redemption, we have forgiveness, forgiven for everything in the past and also from everything from the present and the future." This, by the way, is an astonishing truth that we find in the scriptures. There are a few words in Greek for forgiveness. The most common one is the one that is used here in verse 7. It means to let go, to release, to send away. Forgiveness is one thing we all need to accept and we all need to give. You know, there's a story that is told in Spain of a father and his teenage son that had a relationship that had become very strained. So the son ran away from home. His father, however, began a journey of search of his rebellious son. Finally, in Madrid, in a last desperate effort to find him, the father put an ad in the newspaper. The ad reads, "Dear Jose, meet me in front of the newspaper office at noon. All is forgiven. I love you, your father." The next day at noon, in front of the newspaper office, 800 Jose's showed up. They were all seeking forgiveness and love from their father. And the best way to get to that is through the scriptures. It really gives you that sense of wanting to forgive because you understand the forgiveness that you got from the Lord. Let's sum up all these great blessings we have seen so far in this chapter from verse 1. We're told that we are now Jews and Gentiles, called saints, meaning we have been sanctified, set apart, because we now fully belong to God, who actually uses us now to do his work. From verse 2, we are told about grace, we are told about peace, one comes before the other, and once you have them both, you are then prepared to go through this life and to bear much fruit for the kingdom. From verse 3, we are told that great blessings are waiting for us in the heavenlies, and the good news is that they are right now available for the taking, that we have such a great bank account. We're like sometimes like beggars who do not realize that we have so much money in our bank. From verse 4, we are told of God's omniscience towards us. He knew us even before the foundation of the earth. From verse 5 to 6, we learn of this great truth about our adoption, how we belong now to God's family. And in verse 7, we learn of this great redemption that took effect on our behalf through the death and resurrection of Yeshua, because we are forgiven. And I love the way these blessings are given to us. From the New American Standard Bible, the verse 8 says, it says that which he lavished upon us, just like you take a bucket of blessings and you put it on the people. That word means to exceed a fixed number of measure, means to be over. When God gives, he gives and he gives. Here is like, again, a bucket of blessings that he gives to each one of us. And what is our response to all of that? Let's go back to only two places in this section, verse 1 and verse 4, where we have an indication of what is expected for us, because Paul is coming back very soon to tell us what we should do with all these things. In verse 1, we are called the faithful. And in verse 4, we are told that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Faithful, holy, and without blame, this is the mark of the one who is the recipient, who could be the recipient of these great blessings. This is what will come out as we go on in this epistle. That we should be faithful has to do with our faith. The word is similar to believe. It speaks of faith and knowledge. Faith has to be fed constantly, day after day, through prayers, through reading the scriptures, through the study of the scriptures, through communions with other believers. We shouldn't take it for granted, because I've seen many who have fallen from their faith because they thought it will never go away. We had to feed it and keep strong. Keep it strong. Holy and blameless speak of our walk. It speaks of our holiness. Faithfulness, holiness are the key to receiving these blessings that are made available to us. Again, this will come out as we'll go deeper into the word. So these first verses of Ephesians represent such a testimony of love and generosity that cannot be found anywhere else. And it is not yet finished, because as one gets to verse 9, and I'm going to conclude with this, verse 9 and the rest of the chapter, we're told that something that is yet of inestimable value. Here we are told that God, the creator of the heaven and the earth, now wants to share with us some mystery. He wants to have that close relationship with us. Even some facets, he wants to share with us some facets of his will, something no one could ever know except by revelation. Is it not in man's inner desire to want to know things that are hidden, things from beyond? Here God tells us that he is willing to reveal to us many of these things, even some of his inner thoughts, otherwise impossible to know. And beyond this, he further promises us to come to us and to not only reveal these things through his word, but to dwell with us throughout our journey here on earth, in order that we may experience all these blessings and these revelations. This we will see tomorrow, and we will begin with reading verses 8 to 10, and then we will go further. So yesterday we've looked at the first 8 verses of this great chapter of Ephesus, and I don't think that Paul could have said more than what we find in this chapter. It is so packed with information. I don't know how many times I read this chapter, and every time I reread it, I find new things. It's like driving very fast on a beautiful, scenic, and winding road. You know, you have to come back to it and walk it in order to get the feel of what is written in there. Let's read verses 8 to 10, speaking of these great blessings and riches we have seen so far. Paul says, verse 8, which he made to abound towards us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth in him. So here we encounter the first mystery in Ephesians, the mystery of his will. Paul is really the mystery man of the Bible, in the sense that the most extensive usage of this word and concept is given to him. He uses the term 21 times in 18 passages, and this is one of them. In fact, if you want to have the list of the 21 mysteries, it's in the Appendix 6 of Footsteps of the Messiah. First, what is a mystery? A mystery is simply something that was not known in the Hebrew scriptures, but is now revealed in the New Testament. It is then no more a mystery, but it becomes a revelation for us. And the mystery here revealed is about the will of God. It is the mystery of his will. Here I want to tell you, we are entering very holy grounds. This speaks about God's desire to have all men saved and all things restored. This speaks about redemption, something that he began right at the creation and where in the fullness of time, as it is written in verse 10, all believers and all things will finally be gathered in the Messiah. The mystery of his will demands that all things be restored in its proper order. And the mystery revealed is that this restoration will be done through Yeshua. As the verse 10 says, that in the dispensation of the fullness of time, he might gather together in all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth in him. And notice the words used in this verse, the words dispensation and time, in the fullness of time. These words suggest that God is working a plan through a series of definite and successive stages of time. And this is precisely what he did and what he does right now. The word dispensation is translated in several different ways. It can mean a stewardship, an order, an administration. An English translation, that is of the Greek word, would be an economy. It is the management of a specific period of time. What we are learning here is that the Bible is divided into different periods of times, each period of time with a different design. And in order to understand God's will and God's ways of working, we are to know and understand all these periods of time. Otherwise, we will be lost in his word and we'll mix one period with another and end up mixing one doctrine with another. This is how important it is. For instance, Yeshua spoke of the times of the Gentiles in Luke 21:24. It divided a specific time. We ought to know why it is there for, in order to understand him and in order to make sense of the whole of God's plan. By the way, this period of time, the times of the Gentiles, began in 583 BC with the Babylonian deportation of the Jewish people and will end at the second coming of Christ. This is important for us to know in order to understand the prophecies of the end time. Paul in Romans 5:14 says, nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses. So there's a period of specific time between Adam and Moses. What difference is there with the other periods of time? And what does it imply? How were the people saved then? What was the message in this period of time? Moses saw beyond this time, his time, and beyond the Mosaic law. And in Deuteronomy 30, by speaking of the latter times, he spoke of the end times, a different dispensation of time. We read in Ephesians 3:5 and Colossians 1:26 of ages past. We read in Romans 12:2 and Galatians 1:4 of the present age. We read in Ephesians 2:7 and Hebrews 6:5 of ages to come. So a proper understanding of the Bible will depend on understanding and on the right division of these times. Today the word dispensation has become almost a dirty word because people want freedom. Freedom to read whatever they want in the scriptures and apply whatever they want to whoever they want. The respect of the dispensation of the Bible will not allow them to do that. It cuffs our wandering imagination and allows us to really exercise our free will in following the path God has designed in the scriptures. And importantly, the disregard of the dispensation is at the core of the replacement theology, where Israel is pushed out of the scriptures. And this growing repulsion of the dispensation is sister to a lack of a study of prophecies of the Bible. The two go hand in hand. To reject the dispensation and the prophecies of the Bible is to reject one quarter of the Bible, because the Bible is at least, if not more, one quarter prophetic. These dispensations touch on the body of prophecy in the Bible that are crucial in understanding and making sense of what the Bible and what the will of God is. Chafer, the founder of Dallas Seminary, in an article he wrote back in 1934 in the Bibliotheca Sacra, said that God's program is as important to the theologian as the blueprint to the builder or a chart to the mariner. And he was right on. Dispensation are the road maps of the Bible. John Wycliffe, who played a major role in initiating and establishing the Reformation, along with John Huss and Johann Gutenberg in the 1350 and the 1450, this man Wycliffe is in fact called the morning star of Reformation. He already understood the importance of rightly dividing the word of God in his golden rule of interpretation. Wycliffe wrote, and this is even before the first Bible was printed, says, "It shall greatly help you to understand scriptures if you mark not only what is spoken or written, but of whom and to whom, with what words, at what time, where, and to what intent, under what circumstances, considering what goes before and what follows." And he is right on, because this is precisely the argument of Paul as we see it in 2 Timothy 2:15. Here we find a word that is only used here in the scriptures. See what it says. "Be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." The word, rightly dividing, one word in Greek. In classical Greek, it means to build a road, to lay down a way. In the case of 2 Timothy 2:15, it is to know how to divide the word by its different periods of time. This is possible through knowing the different dispensation of God that speak of God different ways in He deals, or He dealt also in the past. You have in the screen, actually, the seven dispensation of God. We can see in all this dispensation God's attempt to allow man to govern himself, to make it by himself. And through this portion of times, he gives them all possible venues to succeed. But of course, to no avail. And when Paul says in Romans 1:20 that at the end, those who reject God will be without excuse, this dispensation will testify against them. The two first dispensations, that of innocence and conscience, God called on the intellect, the intelligence and reason of man. But these things cannot save men. The next three, that of civil government, of the patriarchs, and the Mosaic law, until the tribulation, God allows man to govern himself. But these dispensations show that he cannot. So much so that at the end, when Jesus comes back, it says that unless those days were shortened, no flesh will be saved. He had to come in order to stop the complete destruction of humanity. Then you have the dispensation of grace, where God makes things as easy as he could. Just say that you are a sinner and recognize Jesus as your personal savior, and you shall be saved. Even that, man has a hard time to recognize. It must be the most difficult thing to say, considering the number of believers we have now. And the last one, that of the millennium, God is even more gracious in that he bound Satan. Maybe it was his fault. But even this period of time really shows the depth of sin in man and shows that he could be only through faith and by grace that he can be saved. These dispensations stand as a witness to man's failure to make it by himself. And these dispensations tell us that while God graciously changes his methods of work, he himself never changes. And you will find the same message in all these dispensations. First, they all simply show that man is a sinner, and as a sinner, he cannot attain peace, and that he's going to his destruction. Second, and very importantly, restoration, peace, and harmony, and salvation are possible only through God and on the ground of a sacrifice or a death. This you will find in all the dispensations. This is the message we draw from the doctrine of dispensation. And the end result of this period of time, as we read in verse 10, is that he might gather together in all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth in him. This could be seen as a history. This dispensation could be seen as a history of the grace of God. So all this revelation brought Paul in verse 17 to 18 to pray that the Ephesians will receive this blessing. There he just pauses in praises. See what he says, verse 17 and 18. that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance to the saints. This prayer teaches that it is the Holy Spirit that illuminates the believer in the understanding of God's program. The reason the believer can understand God's program, understand why God does things sometimes one way and sometimes the other way, is because of the witness of the Spirit of God. What he prays about here is so that we allow the Spirit of God to teach us these mysteries enclosed in our Bible. Our Bible can be a book of revealed mystery. And these things are revealed only to believers. We know that verse, 1 Corinthians 2:14. But the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can we know them because they are spiritually discerned. This is important to realize even before we open up our scriptures. You know, there was an article in the March 2009 issue of Christianity Today. A very interesting article about a man who brands himself as a relatively well-read and well-educated person. He graduated from Harvard University. This man, who does not believe in God, undertook to read the Bible and wrote a book about his findings. So I was very curious to see what someone who does not believe in God can draw from his Bible reading. The end result is really a mess. The book is about man's attempt to understand the Bible without the Spirit of God. Let me tell you about his findings. First, this book has a long title. It's called Good Book, The Bizarre, Hilarious, Disturbing, Marvelous, and Inspiring Things I Learned When I Read Every Single Word of the Bible. The author's name is David Plotz. This is what he said after he read the Bible, and I quote, he says, "I am so disturbed by the God that I found there, a God who seems to be so unmerciful so much of the time and so cruel so much of the time, that's very troubling," end of quote. He obviously did not get it at all. If there's one thing that comes out, especially from the Tanakh and the Torah, is that God is a gracious, loving, and very patient in the face of man's constant rebellion. But even this is not obvious to those who don't want to know him. And not only that, this man, as educated as and well-read as he is, got the story of Jacob and Esau completely reversed. He wrote, and I quote, "I thought Esau was the bad brother and Jacob was the good brother. And no, Jacob is this kind of con artist sleazeball," end of quote. That is certainly not what the Bible says. This is not even a matter of revelation, it's a matter of putting information together. Does not the book of Hebrews call Esau a fornicator and a profane person and Jacob a man of faith? And 23 times in the Bible, God is said to be the God of Jacob. God is not the God of corn artists, but did God so arrange his word so that men like this will believe such a lie? See the conclusion of this author. He literally condemns himself. First, he says, after reading the Bible, and I quote, he says, "I guess I am one of these agnostics who is becoming closer to atheism now because I am so upset by the picture of the God there." Sad, isn't it? And he finally wrote, "I am a Jew. I can't believe that Jesus died for my sins." This is what happens when someone reads the Bible and does not believe in God and searches for things to blaspheme the Creator. They end up condemning themselves. Education or social status have nothing to do with understanding the will of God. God is no respecter of person. God reveals himself to all who have a contrite heart. Like David says, Psalm 51:17, "A broken and a contrite heart, these, O God, you will not despise." And how does one come to have a broken and contrite heart? How does one become a believer? Verse 12 and 13 gives us the progression. See what it says. It's so simple. Verse 12 and 13 of Ephesians 1. 13 and 14, I would say. "In him you also trusted, after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom you also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise." who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. So you have heard, believed, sealed, guaranteed with a great inheritance. Is that beyond wonderful? One first hears the word of faith and produces that in him, as we see it in Romans 10:17, which says, so then faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Once the person believes through faith, then he or she is sealed by the Spirit of God for life. We believed, and then this is it. We are sealed for life. Faith is followed by the sealing. This occurs almost simultaneously, as if God does not lose any time, as he desires so much that all may come to a saving knowledge of his Son, as Peter tells us in 2 Peter 2:9. And the word guarantee or pledge in verse 14 is actually a Hebrew word that was carried into the Greek. And both sound the same. If you know a little bit of Greek and Hebrew, you've got to read the same word, arbon. So in both Greek and Hebrew, this word is a commercial term which speaks of a deposit, of a pledge, or a guarantee. That is a beautiful reality of the promise of God. He sealed us by his Spirit, and this is like a down payment, all right, a down payment of the greater things that are coming to us once we reach in heaven. This speaks loudly of the assurance of our salvation and our eternal security in the Messiah. And after this great list of blessings that Paul now turns to the believers in Ephesus, and there speaks to them from his heart. See what he says, verse 15 to 16. It says, therefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all saints, do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. These people had faith and they kept it. Even later on, 30 or so years ago, later, when Yeshua addresses them, he commends them for their faith. We see this in Revelation chapter 2, verses 2 and 3, the letter to the church of Ephesus. He says, I know your work, your labor, your patience, and that you cannot bear those who are evil. And you have tested those who say that they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars. And you have persevered, and have patience, and have labored for my name's sake, and have not become weary. That is a good description of a good group of people that holds on to the faith. However, Yeshua also says that they had a major problem in that they lost their first love. They will see this a little later. And Paul, of course, did not rest on the knowledge that they had strong faith, but he rightly prayed for them without ceasing. We should never cease to pray, especially for the people God puts in our hearts. Paul must have had a long prayer list. I don't know how many people there were in that church, but I'm sure that Paul brought each one of them to the throne of grace. I don't know if you are using a prayer list in your prayers. How many people use a prayer list? That's good. I mean, this is, I've learned that men of God in history did have that prayer list. I mean, prayer list can have maybe 150 names or so. So we do forget. By the way, I did put a sample of prayer list in that table over there. If you want later on, you can pick it up and that will help you to build one for yourself. And there's something he says in the following verse, verse 17, that is quite interesting. It says that the Lord of our God, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. See what he says here. That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, I'm sure that those who deny the divinity of the Messiah relish that verse. And it's something that we will avoid saying today for fear that a Jehovah's Witness will appear suddenly and says, you see, I told you so. But Paul had no problem with understanding the Trinity. Jesus was both human and God. And this verse speaks of his humanity, and as a human, God is his God. It is as simple as this. And it's quite appropriate in the context, since in the following verse, verses 20 and 22, we read that God, the Father, raised him up from the dead so that he will be the head of the church. In order to die, Jesus had to be human. We should not restrict ourselves and bring the humanity and the divinity of the Messiah together. Both are a wonderful truth of the scriptures. Let's read these powerful words that we have in verses 19 to 23. Here we have a condensed history from the incarnation to the exaltation of Yeshua. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him in his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principalities and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. That is, I want to tell you, so well written. In here we see a movement from the humanity of the Messiah to his divinity. And this is reminiscent of what the Spirit says in Hebrews 1:5 that gives us the conclusion. There we read, but when he again brings the firstborn into the world, he says, let all the angels of God worship him. Worship, I want to tell you, is only to God. Here it is given to the Son. When the fullness of him fills all in all, when God will be all the angels will worship him because Jesus is God. So this first chapter of Ephesians can be a refuge and place of great encouragement for all as they remind us of who we are and how rich we are in the Messiah. But there is a reason why Paul begins this letter with the listing of this overabundance of gifts. Paul did not write this letter just to tell us how blessed we are. There is, I believe, a strategy here. Paul mentions these things first as a preparation of what he's about to bring out in the rest of this letter. These are a foundation from where another long list of things are brought up. And this time, this list is about the problems and the shortcomings of this church. After the riches of the first chapter, there's a floating question that hovers over the rest of the letter. The question is, what are you going to do with the blessings the Lord is now giving you? Does our lifestyle reflect these things? Does it reflect our position with God? The members of the church of Ephesus did not seem to have fared very well. We know from history that some 30 years later, after the writing of these words, this church of Ephesus received some severe warnings from Jesus. We see this in the book of Revelation again, chapter 2. It is to this church that he said, in verse 4, nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love. Despite these great blessings, they had lost their enthusiasm and their passion for God and his word. The same passion that is found when one first meets Jesus, when you first met Jesus, you wanted to tell the whole world. It shouldn't change. This entanglement of this world reduced their field of vision, and they lost their favor. It is to them that Yeshua gave that very strong warning in Revelation 2:5. He says, remember therefore from where you have fallen, repent and do the first work, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. The lampstand, where are they? These are the works, the fruits of the church, the fruits of each believer. They have become so indifferent that Jesus tells them that he's about to fire them for their Christian service. If they did not repent, they were in danger of becoming a community meeting center and no more a church of God. So what kind of problems these Ephesians failed to resolve? What then, where did they fall? How did it all begin? And as we're going to encounter these problems, we're going to see that the story of the congregation of Ephesus is very similar to the stories of our own congregations. Their problems are very similar to our own personal ones, but they all need to be taken one by one and to be dealt with. This is why I believe that this epistle is so vital for any believer to read and to study. Here Paul will list many problems and ends the book with this great portion that speaks of the armor of God, which is designed for us to properly equip us, so to deal with all these problems he mentions here and more. Now, since these things are brought along with other great revelation, They are so well weaved together that many commentators omitted to see the problems and just brought out these great revelations. This is why many came out and said that Ephesus was problem-free. Let's see some of these problems. It is then at the beginning of chapter 2 of Ephesians, to the Ephesians, that is, that Paul begins our landing back on earth and starts to bring out the contrast between these great things given and the way they were handling them. The first one is found in Ephesians 2:11, where we read, "Therefore remember that you once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by the so-called circumcision made in the flesh by hands." Here we see two groups of people within the church who do not seem to get along very well. The uncircumcision, who are the Gentiles, and the circumcision, who are the Jews. These appellations, circumcision and uncircumcision, the words, the so-called circumcision, gives us an indication of the nature of the problem. It had to do with the Mosaic law, with the wall of partition, which he deals with in this letter. It must have to do with the clash of two cultures in the church, the Jews and the Gentiles. We'll see more of this soon. Paul also warns the member of the danger of division within the church. Look at chapter 4, verses 3 to 4. He says, "Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace," verse 4, "there is one body, one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling." Problems of unity begin at the church in Jerusalem. And this happens to be one of the best ways to destroy a church, disunity among the people of God. Unity in Christ is something that Paul will insist over and over in this very epistle of Ephesians. And living in such a sinful city, he also warned them not to bring the things of the world into the congregation. Look at chapter 5, verse 3. "But fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not even be named among you as it is fitting for saints." Whatever the problem was, they were not even to speak about such evil, not to bring it into the place of worship. These believers had also a problem with unsubmissive wives. See verse 22 of chapter 5. Where he says, "Wives, submit your own husband as to the Lord." You do not say that if the wives were submissives. And they must have had family problems between children and parents. I would not be surprised if it is as a consequence of the lust and submissiveness. Look at chapter 6, verse 1. It says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right." What happens when these things are left unattended? The lampstand of the church is removed, as Jesus warned. This is why it's imperative to take every single problem to deal with it as soon as it occurs. How can we be ambassador of the good news of the gospel if we do not deal with our own problems first? And that one thing that Paul brings back over and over again is the love that one should have for another. This is written over and over in this letter. It is like a commentary of the last six commandments that Jesus summed up by the words, "You shall love your neighbor as yourself." 14 times the word love is mentioned in this letter. Let me list only a few of them. Just listen. Chapter 1, verse 4, he says that we should walk before him in love. Chapter 3, verse 7, he asks us to walk in the Messiah so that we can be rooted and grounded in love. Chapter 4, verse 2, we are told to bear with one another in love. Verse 15, we are to speak the truth in love, and so on. It is really in Ephesians 1:15 where we see that great relationship between the love for others and our relationship with God, something you cannot actually detach one from the other. See what he says, 1:15. "Therefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and in your love for all the saints." See how Paul links the two love? If you love Jesus, then you will have love for the saints. This goes hand in hand, from vertical to horizontal. If one finds it hard to love his neighbor, it is just surely because that person has difficulties in their relationship with the Lord. So the relation between chapter 1 and the rest of the book is that of doctrine and the practice of the truth. Now that you have so much, he says, act accordingly. Someone might have said, I thought that all this was free. I thought that salvation was free, but now I have to work so hard. Yes, salvation is free, but after that begins the real work. James 2:7, thus also faith by itself, if it doesn't have works, is dead. Let's now go back to chapter 2, read verse 1 to 3 there. There we're going to find a major problem, or the root of a major problem. This problem is the prince of the power of the air, which really frames the practical part of this letter. Starts here in chapter 2 and finishes in chapter 6, where we're given the means to defend ourselves against him. Let's read verses 1 to 3. And you he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience, among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as the others. Verse 2, according to the prince of the power of the air. What we learn from this passage is that there is a third party that is involved, the prince of the power of the air. This is a big problem. His work and presence is so subtle and understated that we often forget that he exists. But he is in this world and very active in sustaining and fueling all possible bad things on this planet. Yeshua even calls him in John 14:30, the ruler of this world. And later Paul reminds us that our struggle here on earth are against him and his followers, his fallen angel, as we read in Ephesians 6:12, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, and see how well they are organized, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. This we ought to know. There's nothing to fear, though, because all of these forces live under the restriction and limitation that God imposes on them. All of these are only created beings and are subject to their creator even in their fallen state. And the scriptures gives us the beginning and the end of the ruler of this world. For now he is a fallen angel who now has freedom to roam the earth. This is what he does now. Later he will be bound during the messianic times for 1,000 years, then released for a little while, and after that he will be thrown into the lake of fire forever and ever. That is his story. But in the meantime, we are to know that he is very active here in this world, so much so that Paul tells us in Ephesians 4:27 not to give place to the devil. Why does he say that? Because he is like one who waits for any opportunity to accuse us to God. As Peter said, he is as a roaring lion waiting for any of us to sin, so that he can make a big case out of our sins. See what he says, 1 Peter 5:8. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil walks about like a roaring lion, seeking who he may devour. So let's not be under the illusion that we can do things in secret. There's someone watching all the time and accusing us of all things. This is why Paul says not to give place to him. And it seems that the only freedom he has concerning us is to accuse us. See how John describes him, or describes his work of the evil one in Revelation 12:10. He says he is the accuser of the brethren. Now we know he exists. He has no power over believers, but what the Lord allows him to have. I think it was Billy Graham who said in one of his speeches, Satan must be the most frustrated personality in the universe. His army of demons is compelled to obey Jesus, and whatever the devil does to discourage a Christian, God can use for the Christian's benefit. This is a good description of this ongoing war. By the way, see how chapter 2 really begins in verse 2. See how he calls the unbelievers. It says that now works in the sons of disobedience. This is quite a designation for non-believers. That's not very good for evangelism, by the way. But this is how actually the Bible sees the world outside. At one time, all were in that category, but now believers have been redeemed from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of the light of the Son of God. Satan no longer works in us, but he does work against us. So what we see in Ephesians 2:2 is the present abode of Satan, as we see it here and in Ephesians 6:12. We can count that is in all six abodes of Satan, as you have it, in fact, in your handout. The first abode is the throne of God. We see it in Ezekiel 28:14. The second abode is the mineral garden of Eden, Ezekiel 28, also 14. This is why Satan was there in the garden of Eden, already fallen. That was his place before. The third abode is the present abode of Satan, as disclosed in here in Ephesians 2:2 and 6:12. The fourth one is the earth, Revelation 12:7-12. This is when Michael the angels take Satan during the tribulation time and confines him on the earth. The fifth abode is the abyss. This is during 1,000 years. And the sixth and final abode would be the lake of fire, Revelation chapter 20, 7-10. This would be forever and ever. It is then in Ephesians 2 and 6:12 where we find the third abode of Satan. Satan's third abode can be labeled as the atmospheric heaven. And in view of this enemy, it is in the same chapter where begins a list of seven different paths the believer can take. Some are good and some are bad. Let's briefly look at each one of them, as you have them also in your handout. You can follow me through your scriptures also. The first walk is the old walk in Ephesians 2:2, where we read, in which you also walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. This speaks of our previous walk. This is the easiest one. At the beginning of this path, you can imagine some flashing, bright, colorful light inviting you to believe that this is so much fun to take this path. This calls on our old nature. The second one is verse 10, Ephesians 2:10. It's the present walk. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. This is our present work as it should be. Here Paul talks about walking in good works, doing good works, which is the natural outcome of a sanctified life. The third is found in Ephesians 4:1, the worthy walk, where he says, I beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called. The Greek word, axios, means to bring into balance, like weighing all things, measuring all things. The fourth walk is found in Ephesians 4:17. It is the foolish walk. It says, this I say therefore and testify in the Lord, that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk in the futility of their mind. This is the same as the first walk. It is the loudest and most splendid in appearance, but it is the foolish one. The fifth is found in Ephesians 5:2, walk in love. He says, and walk in love as Christ also has loved us and has given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. So walk as Yeshua walk. You probably remember these rubber bracelets. You remember they used to have, I think, WWJD. You know what that stands for? What would Jesus do? This is such a good idea. You know, when we are confronted with those so many walks, we just ask ourselves, what would Jesus take at that time? Usually that gives us pretty good answer. So the sixth walk in Ephesians 5:8 is the walk of light. It says, for you were once darkness, but are now light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. And the seventh walk is found in Ephesians 5:15-16, the careful walk. It says, look, therefore, carefully how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil. The Greek word for carefully, akribos, implies care and diligence. It implies that a person has done his homework before engaging in one path or another. So in all these walks, there's a sense of urgency we see in there. These verses encourage us to walk carefully, understanding that time is short because the coming of our Lord is very imminent. Now let's go back to Ephesians chapter 2, beginning in verse 11, where Paul uses a local problem to reveal yet another great mystery. We will touch upon this mystery and expound it tomorrow. We have seen the mystery of the will, of his will, mentioned in 1:9. Now there is a new one coming. Let's begin by reading verse 11, chapter 2. It says, therefore, remember that you, once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called in circumcision by what is called the circumcision made in the flesh by hands. Here again, we see the uncompromising Paul, who now is scolding the Jews and the Gentiles in the congregation. As he did in the book of Romans, so he does here. Because both groups seem to have gone beyond the boundaries set by the law of Christ. At the birth of the church, the Gentiles began to come in into great number into the church. And so we have there two cultures colliding. Their coming must have worried the Jewish believers. This must have meant for many of them that their Jewishness was in danger of disappearing. And these Gentiles came, of course, with their customs and traditions. So some of the Jewish believers began to impose on them some of the Mosaic laws, such as a circumcision, perhaps kosher food, perhaps even Shabbat, and so on. That, of course, caused a big problem. In fact, this is why, at some point, the leaders of the Jerusalem church, just a few years before, in 48 AD, these leaders gathered to discuss this very problem. This, we see it in Acts 15. In Acts 15, 24, I'll go there right away. We read, since we have heard that some who went out from us have troubled you with words and settling your souls, saying, you must be circumcised and keep the law, to whom we gave no such command. And the conclusion is given in chapter 15 of Acts, verses 28 to 29. It says, for it seemed good that the Holy Spirit and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things, that you abstain from things offered to idols, from blood, from things strangled, and from sexual immorality. If you keep yourselves from this, you will do well. Farewell. This law was given to stabilize the relationship between Jews and Gentiles then, but not everyone likes to follow the authorities settled by the Spirit of God. Some Jewish believers in Ephesus disregarded this decree, still preached the Mosaic circumcision to Gentiles, but to them, God sent the uncompromising Paul. Paul calls the so-called circumcision because true circumcision is that of the heart, just like Moses said right at the beginning of Deuteronomy 30, verse 6. And on the other hand, these Gentiles were not scot-free. Paul then turns to them in the following verse and reminds them not to take advantage of the immaturity of these Judaizers to bash all Israel. And he reminds them of something very important in verse 12. That the Gentiles, in coming to faith, joined the commonwealth or the fold of the remnant of Israel, and not vice versa, as many might think today. And he says it in very strong words. Look at verse 12. That at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. That is tough. And that must have been proportionate to their inflated response to the Jewish believing minority in Ephesus. We'll keep on tomorrow in looking at these things, but I will end with an illustration. It's actually an old illustration. The story might not be completely true, but there's a lot of true elements in it. The setting of this allegory is in one of the most horrible blood-wrenched periods in Earth history. The rise and rule of Hitler, during which some 6 million Jews perished, among which were many, many Jewish Christians. Hitler was to visit a cathedral on a specified day. In preparation for his entrance into the cathedral, the officiating clergyman announced to the audience, "All those whose fathers are Jewish will now withdraw from this cathedral." Many arose and moved toward the exit. Then the clergyman announced, "All those whose mothers are Jewish will leave the sanctuary." With this announcement, the marble statue of Jesus Christ at the front of the cathedral became animate and crawled down from his cross and sorrowfully and silently left the cathedral. Of course, this is an allegory, but one cannot detach the Jewish element from Christianity. I would not want Jesus really to leave my place of worship. This allegory shows how connected the Christians and the Jews are. We'll see more of this tomorrow, and we'll see how the Gentiles have joined the commonwealth.